Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Radio. I always forget that Blog Talk commercial. Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Goddess Suite. Who's on the line?
Well, Sister Love is here in the house.
Hello, Sister Love. How are you doing today?
I'm doing wonderfully. I'm feeling blessed and loved.
That's right. That's what it's about. That is exactly what it's about. Are you excited for tonight's show?
I am so excited. Holistic Gal. I really wanted to bring this topic to the people for the longest because, you know, our journeys out of the bondage of Christianity, we want to share our knowledge and share what we've learned all these years, you know, throughout the journey that we have, you know, come out of that, and the things we've seen, the things that, you know, were taught to us, we learn, and that we learn independently on our own through the journey, so in our elevation. So we want to share that with everyone. So, yeah. Are you excited, Holistic Gal?
Yeah, I am. I read our guest's bio, and I'm like, I'm very interested to see what he has to say about religion and Christianity and where everything originated from. And I think this is going to be a real hot show tonight. What we're going to do, we're going to take a little couple of minute break, and we're going to play a song you will know, because after tonight's show, you will know. You will know the origins of religion. It's so, so important, and we'll be back.
With the
All right, we're back. How you guys doing?
Hello.
Mystic Feather, Sister Love.
Yep, I'm
good
here.
Good evening.
Hi, good evening.
Hey.
All How's right. everybody tonight?
Absolutely wonderful, wonderful.
Beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
All right, well, Tuesday's topic, we will, tonight, guys, we will be discussing the origins of Christianity and how our history was stolen and rewritten with our special guest, guest historian and author of the book, Wake Up, Young Black Males, Life is What You Make It, and How Did I Get Here from a Kushite to a Thug, Mr. Steve Johnson. He will be joining us a little later. So,
yes.
This is definitely a show you guys don't want to miss, and you're lucky because you tuned in. So, religion. Who wants to start off about religion? Do we want to talk about our journey?
yeah. Yes. This is Mystic Feather, and I'll start off a little bit with my journey because it's been a long one. Growing up, you know, really didn't have, like, a set religion. We believed in God and Jesus, but we weren't, like, regular churchgoers. But as I got older, I started to see that this is something that, you know, is smiled upon, you know, going to church, being this person that goes to church and lives by the law of the Bible and all this. So, you know, eventually, you know, you're supposed to do the same thing, you know. So I'd say probably like 9 years ago, you know, I was going to church and it was good. It was great. I liked it. I liked the people, liked the energy there. But I started to have like, I guess you would call it a spiritual awakening. So a lot of different types of spiritual things started happening to me and I couldn't understand what they were. And so when I went to church and I spoke to my pastor about it, he told me that it was evil, demonic, and so all of these good things that were happening to me, like, you know, visions and all of this stuff, after he told me that, it was like it put a seed of fear in me. And ever since then, everything I would dream would be negative. I would feel negative things around me. So it just turned it sour. So I never really got any clear explanation of what was going on. So, you know, it was just like years of jumping on and off the bandwagon, you know, and I love things of the occult, like numerology, and those. I've always been drawn to those things since I was young, so I've always read about those things. And but, you know, when you're in a Christian church, you feel guilty for wanting to, you know, read about those things or read about your horoscopes and, you know, ghosts and these things going on because, you know, the Bible says X, Y, and Z. So, long story short, I kind of made my transition over. I want to say it was when my sister came back from Arizona with some crystals, because I was kind of on the fence because I wanted to know more, you know, things weren't adding up, you know, as far as the Bible and you know, the churches and all of these things going on. So I just, you know, decided to have a one-on-one with God and the Creator and tell the Creator that I wanted my journey to be pure, you know. And if it comes back that Christianity was true and right, then so be it. Then I will be a Christian. But since I've been on this journey and the places I've been going and things that I've been seeing, it just released me from that fear of being, feeling like I shouldn't ask questions, I shouldn't know too much, and all of those limitations. It just seemed like free from that, you know, the more I started to learn. So I came across a pastor named Ray Hagen on YouTube, And he actually was a pastor. He was well-studied and, you know, his family was, you know, deeply rooted in the church. They were in the South. But he came across, you know, the truth about the Bible and its origins. And I started to listen to him because I said, who else better to listen to than someone who was born, bred, you know, had everything to lose because, you know, once you start saying that this isn't true, especially down South, they're going to crucify you because, you know, being a Christian is a big thing in the South. So, but this man was willing to put the truth out there for the sake of the truth. You know, he felt as though, I don't care what they say, the truth has to come out. And then when he talks about how other pastors knew of the truth, and they're just going along with the program because they're making money off all of these people that have no clue, that are patronizing these churches and doing everything that they're being told to do, being sheep. You know, he went against all of those things. So I suggest you all check him out, too, because he was really influential in me getting over the fear of stepping out and exploring other parts of spirituality instead of religion. And so that's a little bit briefly about my beginning. So, Mystic Feather, that was Feather.
All right, Mystic Feather, we have our special guest is here in the Goddess Suite. We have Brother Steve Johnson, historian and author. Let's welcome him to join the conversation. We're so excited to have him. Yes. All right, Brother Steve, are you ready to join in?
I am here. Sister, thank you so much for having me.
Oh, you are
thanks
so
for coming.
Thanks for coming. We're so excited to have you.
I'm excited to be here. You know, it's a very important topic, you know.
Yes, I can't wait to get in it.
So what led you on this journey to become, like, to be a historian or just to learn these historic facts surrounding specifically, like, religion? Like, I know you have a lot of aspects of your knowledge, but we're going to focus just on the religious aspect of it. So what led you down that path?
Okay. Well, first of all, I've always been an avid reader, even when I was a young dude, you know, in the hood, as we call it. I always read, you know. I was getting into stupid things as a young dude out there, but I always kept a book with me. But I was reading at the particular time when I was younger, I was reading a lot of European history. I was, like, obsessed with, you know, the Greek scholars, Plato, Socrates, and Aristotle and them dudes. And as I became, like, in my mid-20s, I started to meet different elders in the community, and they seen it. I like to read, and they said, brother, you know what, try this out, check this out. And they start giving me books like The Destruction of Black Civilization, Christianity Before Christ by John G. Jackson, different things like that that basically turned the light on. And ever since then, I've been in one way or another every single day researching one aspect of our history or not, particularly religion. I grew up in a Christian home. Both of my grandmothers, and this is a story I like to share real quick, both of my grandmothers lived on the same street in one of the poverty-stricken towns here in Pennsylvania. And because one grandmother was Seventh-day Adventist and the other was Baptist, they didn't speak to each other. So as a child, I said, man, hold on, there's something wrong here. You know,
yeah.
They fight over who Jesus is. I'm like, man, this is strange. I'm not, you know, and this is a true story. I wasn't allowed to go across the street to see my other grandparents and my other cousins because of religion. So I said, hold up. Something's wrong here. I said, something ain't right. So, you know, that curiosity led me to start studying and trying to figure out, you know, where it came from. You know, how it spread across the world so fast, and, you know, why there's been so much bloodshed because of it, you know? That's a small synopsis of my story, but, you know, it's a real powerful point that, you know, I could not speak to my people because they believed in a different Jesus than, you know, one side of the family did.
So there's different Jesus.
Yeah, different Jesus.
Did you
did you have a moment when you're like feeling like, am I the only one that gets that this is not right? Did you have that feeling growing
yes,
up
I did.
With that?
I did. And the one thing about it is I didn't know till later that, you know, something was wrong. But at the time, I'm looking around, I'm like, man, should I say something? You know, I don't know if I'm, you know, if I feel weird, if I'm the only one thinking this, but
right.
Definitely I knew something was wrong from the beginning. You know, there was times where I would, you know, I remember just arguing with my, I don't want to go to church. I don't want to go to, you know, so it was something about my spirit that knew, you know, something
yeah.
was up, you know. And it did, I want to say it did do good for her. You know, she, my grandmother was a beautiful woman. She didn't drink, smoke, very respectful.
Mm-hmm.
I barely heard her cuss, you know what I mean? So it's like she's a great person because of, you know, her belief in Christianity. She just didn't know that it was Ptolemy on the front of her Bible.
Oh, my God.
Wow.
Yeah.
It's amazing. When the Bible speaks, the very thing that it speaks about, well, the message that Jesus came to give about love, and here we are professing this religion, and we're not even following nowhere near the things that are written in this Bible that we follow, and we want everybody else to follow it too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
Do we have the ability to think beyond belief, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. So, Brother Steve, tell me about the Council of Nicaea. What is that?
Great question. Well, you know, to start off, you know, you gotta look at Roman history when you look at Christianity, modern Christianity, I say. The Romans played a huge role in, you know, what we now know as Christianity, starting in you know, around 190 A.D. with who they call Saint Tantius. The Council of Nicaea came a lot later in 325, but several things happened prior to the Council of Nicaea happening that allowed it to, you know, become the most powerful council that we now know of, you know, as far as Christianity is concerned. At that particular time in history, Rome was at war with itself. It was called a treacherous seat. There were four heads of Rome, Maximinus, Licinius, Constantinople, who was Constantine's father. They were all fighting for the you know, the, who was going to be the head of Rome. And eventually, Licinius won. Licinius was cool with Constantinople, who was Constantine's father. And Constantine is the guy, I'm explaining to him because he's the guy who's given credit for creating the Council of Nicaea, Constantine. So when you know, the war was over, Licinius ended up winning. Licinius died and passed the power to Constantine, who and his father had died as well. So when Constantine was placed in power, one of his major obstacles was that the people were separated because of ideology. They were believing in all different kinds of gods. You know, they were worshiping the golden calf, who we now clearly understand is Hathor, the Kemet deity. So he said, you know what, I need to find something to unify the people so that we can stop fighting. And you know, because at that particular time, those that were called Christians, and I'll get into that in a second, those that were called Christians were killed in Rome at that particular time. You had the Valerian Massacre, where Romans were executing what we now call Christian bishops, deacons. They even killed the Pope at that particular time in 258 A.D. His name was Sixtus II. So, you know, Romans were killing Christians at that time. So not until 312 when Constantine had his so-called vision, right, where he supposedly had a dream where he seen in the sky a cross, and then on top on the words on the cross said, "With this sign you shall conquer." He woke up and said, you know what, let me put something together. You know, so he sent the best scholars at that particular time, you know, to different places of the world, particularly Africa, because as we know, the Ten Commandments eventually came out of the 42 admonitions of Maat. So, you know, in 313, Constantine and Licinius, as I mentioned, told all Romans to stop killing Christians. 321, Constantine decreed Sunday as the day of rest. Now, what Constantine did was, during the Council of Nicaea, is create what they call canon laws, brothers and sisters out there. They're called canon laws. These are the laws that set forth the origins or the early foundations of what we now know as modern Christianity, the Roman Catholic Church. One of those decrees, one of those canon laws was that Sunday was the day of rest. They said, Sunday, this is the day we're going to worship. Now, after, they sat down, they put all these different information from all across the world, different stories, different mythologies, allegories, whatever you want to call it, they put it in a pot, and they started feeding it to the people. Now, at that particular time, Constantine had a lot of trouble. A lot of members of his family were saying, dude, you're doing something. Something ain't right with this, man. This don't feel right. Why are you doing this? You shouldn't be doing this. So, in a book that's called The Life of Constantine, any of you out there that are interested in studying his story, you'll see that he eventually killed his wife, his mother-in-law, his brother-in-law. He killed a lot of his family members because they were going against him. And that just shows, the mind state of this man. Also, he didn't get baptized until 3 days before he died, y'all. So that shows, again, the brother who put forth the energy and the council of Nicaea really didn't look at it as a spiritual thing. He was looking at it as a political way of gaining power in his country, unifying the people. So that's basically a synopsis of the Council of Nicaea, which was one of the first councils. After that, you had different councils, the Council of Ephesus, the Council of Chalcedon, the Council of Constantinople, the Council of Ephesus, which is a very important one. That was in 431 A.D. That's when you had them I'm using my words very carefully, still the Egyptian or the Kemetic story of Asar and Aset. And they created Mary, the mother of God. So we got to understand that this thing was created from the pieces of African spirituality, the periphery of African spirituality, as Dr. James Small says. And it was looked at as a way, again, to unify the people. So that's what the Council of Nicaea is, and basically a basic breakdown of what that was.
Oh, okay. Wow.
Beautiful.
And So Constantine basically made these things up for control,
right,
and power and political gain.
Right.
And that's interesting because religion to this day, when you think about the power of Rome and how they use religion for peace and control and political gain, even in our country, which is like a Christian country,
right,
and how they use religion for that, to control me. And that's interesting how the intention.
Brother Johnson, can you please elaborate on how? Hello.
Yes, I'm here.
Oh, Can you elaborate on how did it come about far as the slaves getting introduced to the Bible and the programming that started with this?
Good question. Great question. Basically, we were given Christianity through different Bible verses that was translated to us. One thing I always talk, when I talk to Christians, I say, we didn't understand this bastard language we now call English at that particular time we were introduced to this Bible. The early slaves were allowed to worship only until they realized that it was a way for them to unify. What they would do was they would, the different African tribes, whether it was the Mali people or, the Bamdiwa or the different tribes that they would go into a room and they would separate, they would all worship to their particular god, then they would come back together and try to communicate because we need to understand that there were different languages in Africa, and sometimes they would mix you up, and you didn't understand the other person that was sitting next to you. You had no clue what the heck he was saying. So the early Christian oppressors who brought us over here on ships like the Good Ship Jesus and these different ships that had, their Christian symbol on it, they brought us here, and they slowly taught us different verses, to keep us subservient, right? They wanted us to look at it and say, okay, things will get better in heaven. Right now you're going through some things, but it'll get better in heaven. The Romans understood the how the world looked at a Messiah, or what the Islamic brothers call a Mahdi, right? They understood a Messiah. So they created the Jesus figure for that specific reason. And when you look back and you understand, you say, okay, how did they create this Jesus figure? You know, first of all, they argue back and forth, was Jesus divine or was he human? We need to clearly understand that. In 449 AD, the Second Council of Ephesus, they argue back and forth, was Jesus a human or was he a man? Then in 451, I believe, the Council of Chalcedon, they basically said, okay, he was both human and divine. So we need to clearly understand that the people who created this religion didn't agree on what it was. They fought right. back and forth. They argued back and forth. And, you know, when we got here to this country, they you know, were different beliefs. There was different sections of it. You know, you had Protestant, you know, you had Catholic, you had Lutheran, you know, these different sections. It was given to us because we are a spiritual people. And we adapted to that savior figure because we needed something to get us through those horrible conditions that we were subjected to. You know what I mean? When you look at Cecil Williams, the black preacher who grew up down south and changed the whole landscape of, you know, how we looked at Christianity and how we believed in it. You know, they used music. Thomas Dorsey, who created blues music in Chicago, right, moved to Atlanta. And he blew up around the time where Ma Rainey's time, for those that might be familiar with her. And he influenced Christianity severely by, you know, giving us music, right? Because we are spiritual people. We like music, and that music was a way for them to draw us in. You had people like Father Divine during the Great Depression who was speaking at the same time Noble Drew Ali was around. And he was a Christian who was very heavily influenced in allowing Christianity to grow with our people. So, you know, it was looked at, you know, as a way for us to escape the pain through song, through dance, you know, the ring shout, whatever you want to call it. It was given to us again through our oppressors, and translated the way that they wanted to translate it. And we started to believe it and take it on, and generation after generation after generation, you know, these stories and these allegories were passed on and eventually became part of our everyday life. And to this day, we haven't been able to figure out exactly, most of us haven't figured out, you know, where it's come from, why it's here, what did they use it for, did they use it for spirituality, or was it a way to control people? That's something we need to understand. Because we've been believing in God for a long time, or creator, or whatever, whether you call it Amun, Ptah, Shishu, Jehovah, Christ, Oshun, Shango, Allah, Oyah, whatever, Arumala, whatever you want to call this creator, we as humans or mankind, we've been believing in the spiritual creator for a very, very long time. It's just when we had these Romans come along, right, and they looked at the Per Imhuru, which was written in 10,000 to 7,000 B.C., they took that Per Imhuru, which and then they made the Pentateuch version, which was the first five books of Moses. From that, they made the Greek Septuagint version in 250 B.C., which was the Greek version of the Bible. From that, then we had the Romans, which is very important, brothers and sisters, the Latin Vulgate version, which is the Roman version. That was written in 400 A.D., right? Right after that, we had, what, as I mentioned earlier, St. Pantheus come up out of nowhere. This black brother from Ethiopia come out of nowhere and run this school that was created in Egypt, in Alexandria, after this so-called Alexander the Great took over and put his general in power, Ptolemy. Now, this is a lot that I'm trying to get, but I'm trying to simplify it so that we understand that all that there were different versions of the Bible. They changed things in each version. From the Latin Vulgate version, we get the Babylonian Talmud, which is the Hebrew version. That was written in 1342 A.D. That's where we get the Ham story from. Those that aren't familiar with the Ham story, that's why these Europeans were able to use the racism, because they believe that we were cursed with blackness, right? Mm-hmm. With the Ham story. From that, we get the Old Testament version. From the Old Testament, we get the King James version written in 1611. That's a whole other conversation in itself, right? That King James
That's
version.
A whole other piece.
Because a lot of our people are reading that right now to this day and believe it word for word.
Oh, and well, you would get slapped upside the head if you read anything other than King James version.
That's
right.
Yeah, they don't play around.
Love their King James Bible.
They don't even know
what
King James is.
You know?
They don't even know that, brother.
They'll snatch your Bible up quick.
What
version is
that?
How about... what is that book created by Hermetes Aldecabalian? how does the Kabbalion, because I heard the Kabbalion, that book was written hundreds, like many, many years before the Bible was put together. Mm-hmm. So how does the, have, do you know anything about the Kabbalion and the writer, they said that's Hermetes or whatever, isn't he, is, was he pre-Kemet or?
Yeah, Hermes.
Hermes
is really Tahuti. And the Hermetica is probably the book you're referring to. Yeah, and that's basically Tahuti. Again, you know, when we look at books that, you know, we say are ancient, mm-hmm. in one way or another we could all trace every single one of those books in one way or another back to our Akebu land, Africa, whatever you want to call it, right?
Mm-hmm.
You can trace that back if you look deep enough. When you look at the story of Christ and, you know, when you look at the different stories of Christ throughout history, you see, that gives you a better understanding of, okay, these books were written in succession. Certain books were written, copied, plagiarized from other books. You know, you had these different mythologies, these different stories. You know, Heru of Kemet was one of the same stories as Jesus. But when you talk about the Kabbalah, you look at different Asiatic cultures who, again, in many ways have, you know, get their information from, you know, Kush, mm-hmm. Ethiopia, the Sudan, Africa as well. You know, there's pyramids in Cambodia, brothers and sisters. There's pyramids all over Asia right now with the same Olmec face that is in Mexico. You know, so, mm-hmm. you know, when you dig and you dig and you dig, you in one way or another, you come back to, you know, they're them getting their source from Africans. Because a lot of that knowledge, you know, comes up out of, you know, what we call the Nile Valley.
Yeah, I was wondering about the ancient Sumerians. Now, since their writings are supposed to be the oldest writings, they're often depicted as white people that look like Greek. So, mm-hmm. But also I've heard that the Sumerians are black. Can you elaborate a little bit on the true origins of the Sumerians? Because I think it's important, because that's, you know, they're real important due to the fact they were real important in creating civilization and bringing about different things, the civilization. So
yeah,
I know anything.
Yeah, definitely the Sumerians, and that's a misconception, them being the oldest people and having you know, they're what I would call Johnny-come-lately people. They're mixed between Mesopotamian and Phoenician. They're Johnny-come-lately. They have taken credit for a lot of things. And that's my biggest thing with a lot of these religions. They've taken credit for things that were in place thousands and thousands of years before they were even, you know, as part of a group, you know. Even before we had what we now call Eurasia or Europe or any of these places, you had spirituality deep down in the heart of Africa. You know, Kenya, Uganda, Tanzania, these different places where, you know, civilization was born.
Mm-hmm.
When people say that the Sumerians were, you know, the original people, they had the original information, that's so not true. They got a lot of their information from Africa as well. And that's a whole other show in itself, sister, to get into that.
Yeah, I mean, could it be
standing,
that that's
yeah.
as far as they could find themselves? That's as far as they can go back for themselves?
Yeah, exactly. And then they don't want to go back any further because they know that if they dig and they dig, they're going to realize that one way or another they got their information from an African. And, you know, a lot of people don't want to admit that. Even a lot of our people don't want to, you know, attach themselves to Africa. They're afraid of that.
And I mean, they're converting so fast over in Africa, you know.
That started way back in, you know, in 325, where you had the Askum, which is a kingdom in Ethiopia. A-K-S-U-M mm-hmm. is how it's spelled. It was a kingdom in Ethiopia that basically declared Christianity as their religion. This was back in 325, so you can even go back further than that. You know, when, you know, our people in Africa started to, you know, adapt and call Christianity their religion. And ever since, you know, we've been beefing, you know, back and forth.
Yes.
You know, you have certain areas that are Islamic, certain areas that just don't want to deal with neither one.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it's a serious thing how Christianity was given to our people, you know, through missionaries,
right,
through people who
and
came
it, and it divides
the so-called people.
It seems like it's another way to keep us divided, too, because...
Oh, definitely.
You know, if you're not a churchgoer, it seems like you're not, like an outcast or something. You know, it's just,
mm-hmm.
you know, always that stigma attached to going to church. But why do you think, Brother Steve, that the fear is so strong amongst the Christian community to research for themselves the information? Why aren't they researching it? Why are they scared?
Yeah, because people have the inability to think beyond belief. They don't want those, you know, securities that they've built up for so long, all their lives, be broken down by, you know, just a few sentences. You know, it's real shocking to see how many people that are afraid of the truth. You know, I learned real early that when you tell someone the truth or what, because first of all, there's no need to defend the truth. Let's make this very clear. There's no need to defend it. Plus, when you tell someone the truth, sometimes they take it the wrong way. They end up turning it on you. You the devil. You going to hell. You know, you know, say that when I ask them, you know, why y'all have purgatory or what's feudalism? You know what I'm saying? Like, what? You know, do you even know what this stuff is? And they go, well, what you talking about? I don't need to know that. I believe. You know, and
they tell you that, the preacher told you, as long as you believe, you don't have to understand everything. It's above your understanding.
Yes. And really, even, like I said, even with the same story as Christ, when you understand that there were other stories, Heru of Kemet, Oban of Scandinavia, Crete of Chaldea, Mithra of Persia, Indra of Tibet, Bali of Afghanistan, Joel of Nepal, Zor of Bones, Alcide of Thebes, who was Hercules, y'all. All these people, Cadmus of Greece, Dedru of Japan, right? All across the world, they had the same story as Christ. Born to a virgin, starred in the East, died 3 days later, walked on water, and performed miracles. There's 25 other stories like that, sisters. You understand?
Brother Steve, do you know the story of the Dogon and the... and their Christ story about the nomos?
Yes, very important story.
Can you please very elaborate on that?
Very important story.
That's an awesome story.
Yeah, that's an awesome story. But, you know, with the Dogon people believed that I dwelled in a fresh lagoon. And that was interesting to me. I'm like, man, God is in water? He's in the ocean? He's in the... I said, okay. So, you know, with the Dogon, I think that, you know, a lot, again... most of this information that was traveled up the Nile Valley as it dried up and people started to migrate all the way until we have, you know, the Great Kemet, where we get the Heru story, a lot of this stuff comes from ancient, you know, but prior to that. And the Dogon is one example. They had very similar stories of a savior.
Yeah.
Different wording, different names, different things like that. But, you know, to simplify that story and to make it plain for people to understand, we need to clearly see that a lot of this stuff wasn't just created in Kemet. It wasn't just created in Kemet. That was one of the reasons why I used a Kushite to a Thug, because, you know, everybody at this particular time is stuck on Kemet. You know, Kemet's becoming like a small religion in itself. You know, the conscious community is getting stuck on that. And I'm like, dude, slow down, man. You know, look at the Dogon. Look at the Kushites, you know.
Right.
Look at the people from Uganda. What did they believe in? And you start to see, you know, that they took a lot of different things from these different societies, you know, because they were there prior to them. You know, the Europeans, and when you look at these Greek scholars, and I hope I'm not, I hope I'm answering this question carefully. When you look at the different Greek scholars, they'll tell you, you know, Herodotus, Pythagoras, Socrates, Hippocrates, Plato, Aristotle, Thales, all these different scholars, they'll tell you in one way or another, they got their information from Africa. They went down in Africa and studied.
Yeah.
They went and studied. So, you know,
all
this stuff from Africa, brothers and sisters, all of it.
Brother Steve, what would you suggest for someone that's out there that is Christian or Muslim that has questions about their spirituality, but they're afraid to take that next step. What advice, comforting advice could you give them to help them make that transition of trying to find the truth for themselves?
Great question. In the Bible, it says be prudent, right? Mm-hmm. Be a prudent man. And all that means is to study. What my advice would be is don't take what preachers say for face value. Go
Amen.
Look go look up what preachers say.
Listen to Brother
Double
Steve.
Check it. Double check it. You know, did you such a find it kind of strange that we couldn't ask questions during the sermon? You know,
yes.
Like, I think it's like, you know, why couldn't I raise my hand, stop you, and be like, dude, explain that further, man. You know what I'm saying? We had to take what Pastor said for the truth. That's just it.
Yeah.
You know, he knows all. He's a great man. You know, but Pastor's wrong sometimes too. You know,
why you get somebody in your congregation knocked up? I mean, it's just like so many different things that they do.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, how can you put yourself on a level above others when you're doing just as many ratchet things as they're doing? It just doesn't make any sense. And it doesn't even make sense any further as far as the congregation upholding this. But, you know, once again, I understand that everybody is not destined to be on the same level spiritually, because if everybody was all good and everybody believed the same thing, then, you know, where would the friction and the fun of life be? You know, where would the excitement be? If everything was the same, it would be boring.
I agree. Everybody's not meant everybody's not meant to have that kind of understanding. And unfortunately, too often our people, people of African descent, you know, people of color, whatever you want to call us, they got all these different names for us. But, it's important for us to understand that we played a huge role in how they even got this information of understanding spirituality, understanding that they're, you know, the universe and energy and different things like that. They got a lot of this stuff from us, and that should instill in you a sense of pride, knowing that, you know, they went so hard to try to erase, you know, us from this history, erase us from, you know, they didn't want to acknowledge the fact that we played a huge role. I mean, the list of black saints is about 5 pages long. If you start with name me a letter, and I could read you the names of all the black saints, but we're not taught this. We don't understand that there were black popes and black emperors. September Saviorus, Matildas, Galatius, these different black Roman popes and emperors at this particular time. But after Constantine, y'all, they erased all this stuff. They start, man, look, we can't have like these black people, man.
Right.
You know, because then they're gonna find out the truth.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Can you, Brother Steve, can you talk about the origins of Islam and Muslim? Because that's like the second big religion. We have Christianity.
Yeah.
And we can get into that side of it.
Yeah, well, Islam is another thing. Islam is the last major religion to, pop up, for lack of a better word. Islam basically was founded in what they call the Near East, in the same area as Christianity, by the way, y'all. Okay? Now, Islam is given credit for rising to power through a brother by the name of Muhammad. Muhammad, in his early life, up until he was about 25 years old, was a traitor in what we now call Mecca, which the original name for Mecca was Ma'atka. Now, that's for those that understand, Mecca was called Ma'atka, y'all.
Right.
Okay?
Right?
That's a serious, serious thing. Now, he was a traitor at this particular time, and he sold goods. Now, this brother Muhammad married a very wealthy lady by the name of Khadijah, who had political connections, real powerful lady in the area. He won her favor, married her, then moved into a different group of people and started to realized that something was going on, something was wrong. Now, it is said that Muhammad supposedly, this is going to shock a lot of people, Gabriel, the angel Gabriel, was supposed to come to Muhammad and give him these books of the Quran. So over 20 years, the angel Gabriel supposedly kept coming to Muhammad in his dreams while he was awake and started to give him these different verses. And after, you know, the Gabriel stopped coming, he started to ver- verbally tell it to what we would call a scribe. And this scribe started to write down these different lessons. Now, mm-hmm. once Muhammad realized that something was wrong, and he set out to create a way to unify what we now call Muslims, which we'll call Muslimmen, he was unsuccessful. At that particular time, people was like, man, hold up, dude, something ain't right with what you're saying. You know, we ain't trying to hear that. So most of the people at that particular time didn't want to hear him, so they exiled him. They basically kicked him out of what we call Mecca today, and he went to a place that they call Medina, which Medina is Baghdad, Iraq, y'all. Okay?
Wow.
He went to Iraq. Now, when he went to Iraq, he got to Iraq, and he found a place, and he seen that there were people of different religions all worshiping at the same time in this one area, and they were getting along. They were peaceful. They call this place in now the place that they worship now, they call it the Al-Kaaba, A-L-K-A-B-A, which mm-hmm. Is the shrine that they say basically Abraham built. Okay. Now, the mm-hmm. thing that's shocking about this Quran and Islam is that Jesus, Abraham, Adam, Moses, Solomon are all in the Quran. All of them are in the Quran. Okay, there's different stories. Like for instance, we can look at Abraham as one, right? Abraham is talked about different in Christianity and Islam, but he's still in the book. In Christianity, they say that Hagar gave birth to Abraham's first son, Ishmael, right? And then they said basically he had another son by Sarah. Then they start beefing, and in the Christian version, God told Abraham to exile his son, and his mother, right? Now, in the Islamic version, Abraham doesn't exile his son. They go to Mecca together, right? So what I'm saying is both of these religions share a lot of the same information.
Right.
You know, was again, you know, very influential in each other. Islam basically used a lot of Christianity points. They believe that Jesus, who they call Isa, I-S-A, was basically just a prophet. The proof in the matter is what we now understand, and everybody who wants to understand Islam and how it relates to Christianity should go look up what's called the House of Wisdom, which is a school that was in Medina, which we again is Iraq, y'all. Right? This House of Wisdom, this school, was basically a place where Islam, early Islamic people, and I use that word so we can understand it, Christianity and Jews all build together. They were studying together. They had lectures. You'd have a Jewish lecture, a Christian lecture, and what we now call Islamic lecture, all in the same building, y'all.
All at the same building.
All at the same time. Now, this is the same thing. We got to understand this. In the 8th century, Baghdad was one of the biggest places in the world. It was like New York City, okay? Baghdad in Iraq was one of the biggest places in the world. They had the highest amount of trade, the you know, all kinds of goods and different things, and one of the biggest things there was this place that's called the House of Wisdom, right?
Wow.
Where Muhammad went. He was expelled out of Mecca, went and rebuilt. He is said that he went to Ethiopia and met Bilal and Zayd bin Harith, who helped him form an army, right, of mostly African brothers and sisters. Then he went back, overthrew Mecca, and we now have history, where he eventually, once he overthrew it, he gave this religion to the people. He unified all these different Arab tribes, and I'm simplifying it because there's a lot more to it, but he unified these Arab tribes into one. And they started to spread. They started to move out to different places of the world. And they would encounter these Christians, and eventually they start fighting, y'all. They start fighting.
Wow.
They start killing each other. Then we had what we call these different crusades, right? These crusade wars where we had 10 of them. And it started that basically the biggest crusades were from 1095 to 1291, right? The first one was called by Pope Urban II in 1189. The third one, excuse me. The biggest and the worst one was between Richard I and Saladin. Saladin being Islamic, Richard I being Christian, right? So I'm simplifying the story to say that after Muhammad created this way of life, I'll say, right? Because all Islam is I, self, Lord, and Master, basically submitting your will to God. after he started to push this religion together and formate it, he dies. Then after he dies, we had a serious thing happen where they started to beef between each other. They didn't agree. They started fighting. And then, you know, we have Ali, who founded the Shia Muslims, separate from the other brothers and sisters who now call themselves Sunni. Now, they're still fighting to this day, the Sunni and the Shia. Because after this, the prophet died, he didn't name a successor. That was his biggest mistake. He didn't say, okay, you're going to be the leader after that. He didn't do that. So Ali eventually took one part. Another brother took the Sunnis, and they separated. They started beefing, arguing back and forth. The Sunnis took their power to Damascus, which is in Syria, which is another important point, because when we look at today, what's going on in Syria, y'all? What's happening over there? Oh, wow. What's happening in North Africa?
Yeah.
This is all karma. You see how things – see, when you understand history, you can understand why things are going on today over there in this,
right.
What we call the Middle East, which is really Western Asia. There ain't no Middle East, y'all. It's Western Asia. So, you know, we can see, okay, this is why they're fighting. This is why
right.
We as – you know, when we look at, you know, those of us who are part of this culture believe in Christianity, and we say, okay, them terrorists, them bomb them, kill them. You know, it's the same thing that was going on back then. The same thing. These two different major sections of belief can't agree on whose God is better. Now they want to fight and kill each other. This is what's happening, y'all.
I hope
I'm not being too long-winded,
wow.
You know, but
I just want
y'all to understand that, you know, Christianity and Islam are very, they have very close ties. You know, I've been reading some stuff recently that talks about the Jewish influence on Islam, and we can get into that in a second.
Oh, yeah, I want to get into Judaism.
Really, really quick, Brother Steve, you've been breaking it down beautifully. I have a question that was sent to me. Hold on just a minute. Okay, why... If Christianity and Jesus are not real, why is it that when I go to church, I am able to feel I'm able to feel Jesus' spirit?
That's a question I'm guessing. To answer that to the best of my ability, I think, spirituality and religion is two different things. We need to get that clear right now. If you are a melanated person, you're a spiritual person already. We could tell our mind to do many different things, right? A drug dealer fools himself into believing that, hey, man, if he don't get this drug from me, he's going to get it from somebody else. So he justifies selling poison to people, to his own mother, okay?
Right.
Sometimes we can fool ourselves into believing that this is what I'm feeling when we necessarily don't understand what it is. It's just a spirit. It's a feeling. We're emotional. We can feel the presence of God. One of the things that I believe that Christianity got it right on is that the kingdom of God is within.
Yes.
We have the power to believe and to love and to be spiritual. And you've told your mind that it's Jesus. But do you know what Jesus really is and where Jesus really came from? You know,
right.
That would be my question. And if it makes you a better person, then so be it. I'm not one to sit here and tell anybody to get away from anything. If it makes you a better person, then that's so be it. But please just understand what it truly is. Get into the African spiritual part of it. Understand where it comes from. And then maybe make your decision based on facts and better information as opposed to just believing something that was told to you and regurgitated
right.
to you over the years by someone right. that you love. That's how they got us. They gave it to
that's
us through someone we love.
Mm-hmm.
Grandmama,
mm-hmm.
uncle, mama, daddy,
friend.
Somebody we love taught us this. And it's become a part of our DNA, and we can't understand it. You know, how do we get this out, and how do we clearly understand it better so that we can use it better? Because when you don't understand...
Hello?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Hello?
Yeah, we're here.
Okay. Yes.
Okay.
And also, Brother Steve, could you talk about why, could you talk about the energy? See, from my understanding, all the energy is, you know, the same. Like if you were in a Christian church and you see people falling out, screaming, shouting, becoming possessed, you can see the same thing in a voodoo ceremony or African practice ceremony, or I wouldn't say a Buddhist ceremony, but other cultures, you'll see the same thing. That energy that they call the Holy Spirit, it's called the chi, the ka. It's called different things.
Yes.
It's called different things, and but it's all the same. It's all the same energy, but if you're feeling it, if you were Christian and you want to go to a church that's not your regular religion, you can experience the same thing. I experienced that listening to Christian music, that feeling of the quickening of your spirit. I felt that during Christian music. I felt it during rap music, during go-go music. So how can you sit there and say, this music is evil, you're going to hell if you listen to rap, you know, all of these things, when you can feel that energy regardless of what, if the music is speaking to your spirit, and us being African people, the drums is what activates the DNA in our bodies as it is. So when we hear drumming, that's something that is a natural part of our DNA, to move to that rhythm. And it's cold. There are codes in the way we move our body and what we're listening to in the drumming. So all of that plays an important part. That's why it's very important for you to do your research and go back into your spiritual African roots, because there's so many jewels there. Instead of being whitewashed with this watered-down religion, no feeling, get rid of that. Go back to who you really are. Remember who you really are. You already know who you are. You just have to remember. And that's what we're here for, to try to remember where we come from and our origin.
I want to make that
Brother
clear.
Steve on that.
That's a great, great point, sister. Great point. I couldn't have said it better. And this is, I want to make this clear to all the Christians out there. This is not an attempt to bash you or to put you in a place where you have to be defensive. This is a way where we're trying to just help you understand that you need to look a little deeper. If you don't know what the Council of Nicaea or the Council of Ephesus is, and you are a Christian, you should go look it up.
Mm-hmm.
If you teach me, if you tell me something about what I believe in and I ain't never heard of it, first thing I'm doing is I'm going to look that thing up as best I can. Find as many sources as I can to read that. And when you talk about energy, sister, we just look at the laws of the universe. It's very simple. The laws of vibration. Very simple. The laws of vibration. The laws of cause and effect. The laws of perpetual transmutation of energy. The law of relativity. The law of attraction. The law of cause and effect. All these different things are real. We are a spiritual being. We're a spiritual being trapped in this physical body. So to feel that, like you said, when I play the Ghetto Boys, you know, when I hear certain Ghetto Boys songs, you know, the blind leading the blind, I get that feeling. You know what I'm saying?
We
especially in melanated people, we close to the Creator now. You know what I mean? We gonna feel that feeling now.
I really, everywhere I go, every conversation, like where we live at, is a lot of big mega churches. And a lot of people in conversation, Jesus, like, because Jesus this and Jesus that. So what I want you to please do is please give us the historical background of Jesus. Now, for me, my first thing I knew Jesus wasn't right was a J.
Right.
There is no J in the Hebrew language. You're supposed to be Jewish, but there is no J in their language. So
that's
where I first started. Like, hold up. Mm-hmm. So can we break down this historical fact of this character in the book?
Yes.
Named Jesus.
Named Jesus. Serious. Great question. You know, again, I go back to Roman history. We have to understand Roman history. Why did they create this figure? And where did they get it from? We clearly understand now that they got the story from Kemet through the story of Asar, Aset, and Heru, which
and
they
Isis
call Osiris and Isis, the Greek names, right. We call them Osiris and Isis. I first heard Osiris through a rap song, and one of the craziest rappers that's ever lived called Old Dirty Bastard.
Old Dirty Bastard.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Osiris to this shit. That's what he said.
Yeah.
I said, what?
Yeah.
He said, who we talking about?
Right.
So when you go back, right, and, you know, as a kid, I had no clue. But now
right.
I said, wow, ODB knew what he was talking about. He was on it. They got this story from Africa. And how they got it again, Constantine sent these people out to get this information, come back, the best scholars at that time, they sat at a table in this Council of Nicaea and used different stories, different allegories, different myths, put it in a pot, and created these canon laws, therefore creating this religion that we now call Christianity.
Created.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah.
So
they started to
fight. I mean, they were literally fighting. Was he a man? Was he a spirit? Another thing, too, all Christians out there, understand this. They call him the Lamb of God because they had the Lamb on the cross first. It took them almost 500 years to put Jesus on that cross. At first, they had the Lamb. Now, let's think about that for a second, right? They created this figure. He was created. Now, did he live? There is evidence. You look at Avin Van Sertima's work, and you see a lot of his work in one of the books that Avin Van Sertima, he talks about basically that during the time of Justinian, there were coins that they found where they seen on one side of the coin there was an elephant, on the other side of the coin there was a black woolly-haired figure who they called Jehovah, basically. Now, Jesus, again, basically, they didn't agree. They said, was he divine? Was he human? They argued back and forth, and then eventually they said, okay, he's both. He's both. But my thing is, how did he become God? See, we people look at Jesus as
right.
God, and that's
mm-hmm.
where we make the mistake.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Was
he
the Son of God or was he God?
Never worshipped like that. Mm-mm.
Exactly. Exactly. And why is there, again, as I mentioned earlier in the broadcast, 25 other stories, the same thing, prior, during, and after, the same story, right?
Mm-hmm.
Where you had this figure who was killed in the story of Kemet, Osiris or Asar was killed, chopped into certain pieces, spread throughout Kemet. And by the way, brothers and sisters, his wife, his sister, okay, found his parts in this story, put him back together. But his penis was missing, and she flew over top of the – transformed herself into a bird, flew over top of the part of his body where his penis was, sucked out the sperm as a bird, transformed herself back into a woman and was pregnant.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Then this – he supposedly, right, ascended to what we now call heaven or Amenta, right? So,
right.
You know, these stories, I'm telling you, there's no way you can get a story that close to each other and not have, you know, the one that came first have been copied in some way or another from the person who came later, right?
Right.
Came
and a lot of times they'll take the one that was the hero in the beginning myth, and they'll turn him into the villain in the next myth.
Yep.
It's like
yep.
they just, I mean,
yep.
it's amazing.
Look at what they
how,
did to Hercules. Mm-hmm, the
yeah.
story of Hercules. He was, you know, was the villain, then became a hero. I see the Thebes.
Right.
You know, they got all these stories of Hercules now. They got the rock playing Hercules, you know,
mm-hmm.
you know, which was the closest interpretation of what he looked like because he was not a white man.
No.
You don't live in Thebes. Where's Thebes, y'all? Thebes is Egypt. Thebes is Waset. They changed the name. The Arabs call it Luxor. The white man call it Thebes. But the African called it Waset. Where is that? That's in Egypt.
Wow,
that's right.
Come on now,
yeah.
you got to understand chronological order of things, man.
You got to
do your
research,
people. Remember, the Bible says God did not give you the spirit of fear, but of power and a sound mind. So what's there to fear? Why are you fearing?
Yes.
This is the Bible that you follow, but you're scared.
Yeah.
Why?
Yeah. Good point.
You have to ask yourself that.
Great point.
Cannot live in fear. We're going to go to the lines real quick and see if anyone has a question. This is number 8948. Hello, question or comment or sipping tea?
I have a comment, actually, and I was a little late, so I missed a lot of what was talked about. But I have some house guests, and they're Christian. They believe in their faith, and I was trying to give some advice the other day about why the individual is out of work and they feel like, you know, God has set them down to, you know, set her down to figure out what it is that she needs to do for herself. And once he opens that door for her, she's going to walk into she's going to walk into the right door based on what God opened up for her. And I said, that's not true. I said, you're switching, flopping around. You're moving, going down to North Carolina. You're going back to Maryland. You're going back and forth trying to interview on these different jobs. I said, you have to help yourself. You need to put yourself first and stop creating all this drama for yourself, and you don't understand that. And I said, well, let me just put it to you like this. God said, your Bible quotes that God helps those who help themselves. And she said, yes. And I said, but God hasn't helped you yet. And she kind of, when I said that, she laughed out. It's like it was an instant burst of laughter. I don't know if that laughter meant it was funny to her or she didn't believe what I said. I said, well, you are creating, you are the author of your life. You are creating this drama. God is not creating this for you. So I told her, I said, your Bible said God helps those who help themselves. You're trying to help yourself, but you're depending on a spirit or a God that, well, meaning Jesus, you know. So when I told her, I said, he hasn't helped you in 6 months. So what do you think the problem is?
Great point.
Was I wrong for saying that?
Oh, definitely. Great point.
All right. Thank you, sister.
Thank you.
All right. Let's try another call. This one, number 9161. Question, a comment, or sipping tea?
Hotep, everyone. Hello.
Hotep.
Hello. Hotep.
Okay. Good evening to you. I was listening to the one sister that was saying, what is the spirit that we all have when we go on to church? And it made me relate to the fact that, you know, as the brother said, that we're all spiritual in the universe. We're all the spiritual being. But to me, it ties back to our culture. When we all gather together, there's an energy, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And you bring that energy, all of us are there, we bring that energy into the church. And I know as growing up, when I would go with my parents to places that were predominantly white, what's the word for them, Caucasian people.
Yes.
You know, you didn't feel this. I didn't feel that. I don't know about anybody yet, but you go, for example, you go to the zoo, and, you know, most of the time you don't see too many of us there, you know. And it's predominantly them there. And it's such an estrangement. Like, you know, they're standoffish. I feel more energy from the animals than I do. You know, you can't get no connection
mm-hmm.
from them. You can't
Great
get
point.
No
Great
connection.
Point.
And that's mm-hmm. that energy that we have. When we're amongst each other, we have that energy. And so whatever we put in our minds, we're going to think about. Of course, we're going to make it in fruition. You know, it's going to grow. So, and of course, like the sister said just now, she was saying that the friend that's waiting on something to do it for her. And it's within us. It's all within us.
All within, yes, sister. Yes.
Great point, sister. Great point. I'd like to just add to that. I think that's a great point. When you look, the sister asked me earlier about the slaves and how we got this religion. One thing that came in my mind as I listened to the sister talk is the ring shout, what they call a ring shout, right? The slaves would get, it was a circle dance. They would get into a circle and they would counterclockwise move in a circle. And they would say certain things, sing certain songs. It basically was a secret or sacred ritual that the slaves did that they believed that their ancestors or the creator would get inside their bodies, right? This is how they escaped the pain of slavery. It was a religious ritual. They got in a circle and they sang these songs. They called it the ring shout, right? This is where the Negro spirituals came from, y'all, right? We are a spiritual people.
Yes.
Right? The Igbo people of Africa believe that restlessness of your spirit is what people pay for living a bad life. So when you're a bad person, you're going to have restlessness of your spirit. And mm-hmm. most likely the sister who hasn't, you know, gotten herself together, she hasn't understood that. Mm-hmm. Something's going on with her most likely that she's not, you know, putting herself in a line with what she needs to get from the universe. Simple as that.
Mm-hmm. Simple as that. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and our power together, our energy together, and our power to manifest together collectively is why they have divide and conquer us, why they keep
yes.
us separate, why they don't want us to have unity. If black people were to unify on this planet,
mm-hmm.
we could totally change the world.
Yeah, we'll liberate the world, without a doubt.
Yeah,
right. Without a doubt.
There you go, with peace and love.
That's the cure to everything.
Mm-hmm.
Uniting us.
mm-hmm.
We need
so
to
true.
Start with
most definitely
a religion and start coming together as a spiritual people. And that's mm-hmm. why it was so important for us, the Goddess Suite, to do a show on religion so that we can break free of it. So it's
Brother
so
Steve,
much.
I had a question that I wanted to just to elaborate on to what the sister that called in was
mm-hmm.
About. Could you talk about how now I'm kind of coming into new knowledge of this, but when she was talking mm-hmm. about how in the church, you know, when she was a Caucasian, there was no feeling there,
mm-hmm.
and I'm just coming to the knowledge about the having no melanin.
Right.
Could be equal to having no soul. And we all know
yeah.
that black people, people of color, everything we do has soul in it. We love soul food, soul music. And it's just deeper than that. Soul actually has a frequency, which
yeah.
I believe is the melanin. So I just want Brother Steve to kind of, you know, go in on that.
Great question, sister. Great question. Definitely, melanin is important. Melanin, for those that don't understand it, it's not just in your skin. Melanin is basically a conductor of electromagnetic frequencies that allows a person to pull, retain, and deliver heat correctly. It uses the things that are attacking our bodies on a daily basis in ways that it won't harm us, right? It basically, what the scientists call charged particles or free radicals, right, that are all around us. I mean, we get them from computers, the sun, microwaves. These are things that, and melanin, what it does is it either catches it, uses it the right way, or gets rid of it. And if you don't have that melanin and it's not working correctly, all kinds of things will go wrong. Now, white people have melanin, too. It's just different. They have sulfur at the core of their melanin, and we have selenium. It's different. We get melanin from what's called the pineal gland, primarily, and it secretes a hormone. And there's been studies I've read that, particularly after the Vietnam War, they started studying the brains of the soldiers that were dying, and they started to see that the European soldiers' pineal gland was calcified. It looked like a raisin, y'all. And when they opened up the brains of the black man, it looked like a grape. It was vibrant. It was alive. It looked voluptuous. It didn't look calcified. So therefore, they started to study and study and study, and they came to the understanding that close to almost 60% of Europeans have a calcified pineal gland. Their pineal gland isn't working the way that ours is working. Now, the thing about us is that our melanin is messed up because we're using all kinds of drugs, we got bad sleeping habits, we got poor diets, and we're not using the melanin correctly. So we're just as bad as them, not having it, right? Eating the wrong stuff, living the wrong way, thinking the wrong things could destroy your melanin. Messed up melanin is killing black people, y'all. What melanin does is it helps you make energy by using less energy. That's one of the most important things. They call it a conversion reaction. It also slows down the aging process. It increases the speed of nerve and brain messages, means that your brain can work faster. This is how I'm able to memorize stuff, brothers and sisters. I'll read something, and right away, it's stuck inside my head, and I got it.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying?
It controls poverty. It allows us to use our senses better. It helps us produce vitamin D and other minerals. It helps us store information, as I mentioned. So when you have the proper melanin, you're sleeping right, you're eating right, you're going to live longer. You're going to be able to fight off certain diseases, cancer prevention, different things like that. Melanin comes in different forms. It comes in a gas, a liquid, as well as a crystal form. So, you know, we can have a whole other show on melanin, brothers and sisters.
I'm telling you.
We need to understand that with your opinion. Definitely.
Yeah,
let's do it. And whenever you're ready, let me know. I'll come on and we can break it down.
Oh, yeah.
But the thing with melanin.
I would love it. I couldn't wait to get into that topic.
Oh, let's get into it. You know, it's a serious thing. You know, but when melanin's not working right, your organs can't function right, y'all. So if the melanin is gone, your heart, your liver, your lungs, your sex organs, right? When you talk about ED, all this is coming from your melanin not working right.
Try it all in. Bring it all in.
This is a serious thing, y'all.
Yeah.
And the Europeans are not using melanin right. They don't have the right melanin. Therefore, it causes them to behave a certain way. When you look at Sigmund Freud, and I didn't come up with this. Sigmund Freud, their greatest mind that ever lived, said that the Europeans' two most dominant traits is that they are sexual and aggressive.
Wow.
Why is that? Why have they done what they've done throughout history? Yes, because their brains is not working right. It's just a fact. Mm-hmm. It's just a fact, no?
Mm-hmm.
This ain't, you know what I mean?
It's like they're still in the root chakra, like.
Definitely.
Now, Brother Stephen, this holistic guy, I got a question. Now, as far as reincarnation, I've heard people say that, well, you could have been white in another lifetime. So what does it really matter about the melanin? How do you feel? What's your perspective on that?
That's fucking BS to me. I'm sorry. just to simply answer that, you know, I think that's a bunch of BS. But, you know, again, you know, there might be something that I don't understand, you know, because I'm a very humble brother and I realize that, you know, there's some things that I don't understand. But, you know, what my spirit says to that is a bunch of BS, you know. It is what it is, you know. Again, we all have melanin. We're, you know, this is why the Europeans create these melatonin pills, y'all. They got pills they take in there.
They've been studying the melanin for a long time.
And they don't want us to know what it is now. They got this thing they call junk DNA, where when people of African descent are dying, they finding this substance inside of the liver and the lungs of black people, and it's a black powder substance, and they're saying, oh, that's just junk DNA. That's melanin residue. Serious thing.
Wow. Yeah, so... melanin is spiritual.
How important that melanin is.
Oh, it works hand in hand. Hand in hand.
I just can't wait to have another show on it. You guys will be blown away.
Yeah, it is going to be. Whew, I can't wait. I know the phone lines are going to be jumping then, too. We're going to take one more caller from the queue. One more caller, guys. This is area code. Well, last four digits 1812. Question or comment or sipping tea? Hello? 1812? Okay. I guess they're sipping tea. I'll try one more. This is area code 2250. Question or comment or sipping tea?
Hotep, fam. Hotep, how y'all doing tonight?
Hotep, how you doing?
Hotep. You know what? A couple comments I wanted to throw out there. You know, most people didn't choose the religion that they are in. It chose them, you know, because it was something that was already passed down to them. And one of the things I want to put out there was when Brother Steve was like 9, 10 years old and he was coming over the house, you know, he was already inquisitive to ask about books like the ISIS and other historical type books. And I'm putting that out there to us as a people because in the summertime or sometimes even on the weekend, we need to give our children these type of books to read. We need to put dumbing our children down. We're dumbing them down. Now, we're talking about the melanin, but we got to understand, you know, our babies go at a much faster rate of growth. And we've been dumbing our babies down because we're afraid they're going to get around grandma and say, well, grandma, what about Ptolemy? What about Jesus? You know? And when it comes to our older people, or if you want to call them elders in some instances, yes, because I'm not trying to be disrespectful of them, but we got to question them, and I ain't say debate them, but you got to realize that there's a lot of things that they was wrong about, too. They might want to hold on to what they want to hold on to based upon their own fears and some things that happened with them.
Yeah.
I've heard some great questions by you young ladies today. Brother Steve, as always, man, great input that you've given out there, my brother. I really thank you for everything you're doing, everything you're going to do. And I thank the Goddess Suite for everything y'all doing and what y'all going to do. And I'm going to yield to you young ladies so that y'all can let this brother. Now, I know there's a caller, 708, been blowing my phone up saying they want to get in. So if y'all can get them in, you know, please
all right.
do so.
All right. Okay.
Thanks, brother.
Thanks, brother.
Thank you.
Brother Steve, can you take one?
Thank you, brother.
Brother Steve, can you take one more question?
Oh, sure. As many as you need, sister. I'm here for you.
Okay. Let me check it out. This is area code 708. Question, comment.
What's going on? Listen, I got a. Can you hear me?
Yeah. Yeah.
Here we hear you, brother. Hello? Thanks for calling in.
Yeah. I just want to say I congratulate you all for doing the spectacular job that you all are doing. The people of knowledge, but what I is we know about the Egyptians and things like that, but I don't know. Are you guys aware of the Sumerians? The Sumerians being the first of pretty much everything
we
have.
The Sumerians. Go ahead, Brother Steve.
Okay.
Break them down on the Sumerians.
I pretty much know about that, but.
Okay.
In terms of that, when you talk about the origins of Christianity, you know about Abraham, you know, because he's all tied in with Christianity, Islam, and Judaism, you know what I'm saying? He's pretty much the founding father of those three main religions, you know.
Right.
But a lot of people don't know that this who the God of the Bible, really, what who he really is and what he really stands for. You know, a lot of people say that the God of the Bible, you know, he loves all people and, you know, he hates people. But if you trace back who Abraham really was, and it goes back to the Sumerians, he worshipped a deity named Enlil. And that's when it says in the Sumerians that kingship was lowered from heaven. So that tells you right there that, you know, people want to add, they like to ask the question, where do humans come from? Or how do we gain this knowledge? And if you look at the Dogon tribe, they tell you that a group of beings came from another planet and gave them the knowledge. But there's nowhere in the world that they can tell you about certain Sirius star system bees, you know what I'm saying, certain galaxies that's out there. And we have just figured these things out within the last, 300 years. You know what I'm saying? So they tell you that beings from another planet came and set up pretty much everything that we have today.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying? So I don't know if a lot, you know, when I talk about these things, a lot of people, they want to get, they like to get spooked out about these things. Because they talk about these things in the Bible about, you know, chariots of fire and things like that.
Right.
And,
mm-hmm.
you know, a lot of people,
right.
they get scared about these things, you know what I'm saying? So,
people feel what they don't understand.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, exactly. Exactly. And another thing I want to add is, when I ask the question to people, about in the Bible when it says, you know, in the beginning God created heaven and earth. I tell people, I say, well, if you say that God created everything in the Bible, who was writing for God when he was writing this, when he was saying these things? Because Adam had not been created yet. Who was writing for him? And no one can ever answer that question. And you can't say Moses wrote Genesis because Moses he's not been born to the book of Exodus.
Exactly.
Great point.
You know what I'm saying? And
Exactly.
And then on top of that, with the laws and things like that, a lot of people like to hold laws like the Sabbath and things like that, the Ten Commandments, but people don't know who the first Moses was, which laws. You know, that was King Hammurabi. He dates the Bible by thousands of years.
Yeah, so much information. Right. And this is why we say research. Do your research.
Exactly, exactly.
You owe it to yourself to do your own research. This is why you are here, to do your spiritual work.
Yeah, no one's going to do it for you. So, yeah, okay.
We appreciate your talk, brother. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
I'm telling you, everybody, people, do your work, do your work. Don't take things from man. Yes, mm-hmm. we have the Bible, but there are other books, too. And you have to do your research.
Can you comment on what he was saying that brother was talking about with the aliens?
Yeah, the Dogon.
Starting.
Mm-hmm. I read the story of the Dogon as well, you know, when he talked about different extraterrestrial people sharing mm-hmm. knowledge with them. I think we need to be careful where we get our information from, what source we get it from. Not to discredit what the brother said, because I've read the exact same thing, but I think we need to, you know, again, double check the source. You know, one of the biggest things that, you know, I try to tell people is when you pick up a book, you want to research, okay, who's the author of this book and why did, unless you actually sat under at the feet of the Dogon people, which maybe the brother was able to do, we get a lot of information regurgitated through European sources. So we need to be careful. And the reason why a lot of people are into Kemet is because the white man took Kemet and tried to make it their own. And we said, hold up, man, we better start studying this, man, because we know damn well that they ain't create this. So, you know, and we get a lot of stuff from them. So, you know, a lot of books, a lot of information, a lot of school of thought, you know. It wasn't for, this house of wisdom, a lot of the, you know, Greek information, a lot of the Greek works wouldn't have survived. And, you know, as we know, throughout history, man puts their hand on it, and they change things, they add things, they leave things out on purpose. So, you know, with the Dogon, they were so powerful that, you know, the brother mentioned Sirius Star B. They were seeing stuff, like he said, that we just now start seeing with modern telescopes.
Right.
They were able to use different crystals and different things and be able to see and understand the universe and the planet in different ways in nature, right? We're in opposition with nature right now. The Dogon mm-hmm. understood how to use nature correctly, right. Respected nature, lived by nature. So, you know, that would be my only thing to, you know, response to the brother. And I appreciate him calling in, and it's a great point that he's making. But just, you know, look at African sources. Look at Theophile Banga. Look at Shekonta Diop, or Shekonta Diop is the correct way to pronounce his name. Those two brothers right there is a start for anybody out there that's listening. You can go research those brothers and get a clear understanding. Now, these are African brothers who grew up in Africa, were raised in Africa, that became scholars and was able to translate it to us. You know, now, if you're going to get your information from a Greek source, you might get something totally different. You see what I'm saying, sisters? So you got to be careful now what you're reading and what you're studying.
You have to be. Because because you got to remember our knowledge has been taken, stolen, and repackaged and resold so many times. Anything that you hear, check the source. Don't take it for face value. Check your sources. It's all about jobs down here. Do our own spiritual work. And and in order to do that, you have to not limit yourself. You have to break down all the limitations. Anything that you've been told that you couldn't do as a child, you try to do it. Anything that you've been taught from mainstream media, you need to rewrite your whole life and do the opposite.
That's right. Do the opposite of what you would
do. The opposite.
Yes.
Change the energy in your life. If you're a vegetarian, eat some damn meat. If you are a meat eater, eat you some damn vegetables and get the juicing, because you need to switch this energy up. We are lacking behind. We are messing up. We got to get on point, people. And we have to remember where we come from and who we are for real, because like the brother said, I'm melanin. We're destroying it by doing senseless things with eating, our eating habits, how we take care of ourselves and things like that. And so we really got to, you know, get on the ball so we can reach our full potential in this lifetime.
Yeah, yeah, and stop imitating an imitator. And, you know, John Henry always says,
Preach.
Stop it. Don't make no sense, man. Understand who you are, you know. We've been manufactured by this European, you know. They have manufactured our brains. And, you know, in a lot of cases, we want to be the best white person we could be. I mean, that's just the truth.
I say a lot of that happened, like, with civil rights, too, like, in the 60s.
Oh, yeah.
Like, oh, we can mix with them and be equal. No.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. You can look at then, the one of the greatest European historians of all time. He talks about in his book, People's History of the United States, for those that might want to check him out. He talks about how the early black settlers or the black slaves, as they started to escape slavery, started to relate and get cool with the poor white, what we call poor white trash today, and they started to unify, marry, have kids, different things like that. And the people, the powers that be, said, hold up here, hold up, we can't let this happen. They're going to overthrow us. So this is where we get that whole 40 acres and a mule promise, right, where they said, okay, we don't need this, but we never got it, but they got it. They got it. So what white people don't understand is that the people that are at the top, this 1%, don't give a damn about them either.
Nope.
They don't give a damn about them either. So it's like, you know, and we started to understand that. But, you know, after, you know, we implement this race thing and, you know, they start giving them privilege, you know, what we now call white privilege, they started to detach themselves from, you know, understanding that we were all in the same boat. And therefore, we gave way to Jim Crow and all these different things that happened to us in our history.
Right. And that's isn't right. That amazing? 1% rules the other 99. That is. Can
yeah,
you
that's
please
just,
talk
yeah.
about that, Brother Steve? Because
that's
that
just
is,
terrible. Yeah, it's terrible. And you know, the sister mentioned the Hermetica earlier, and you know, Hermes or the Hermetica, that book. You know, the brother really
it's
was Cahuta. Yeah, they mentioned that in that book that, you know, we eventually will become. You know, under the order of a small group of people. You know, the Greeks call this type of society an oligarchy, right? In Plato's book, The Republic, he talks about the five forms of society, and they are democracy, aristocracy, timocracy, dictatorship, and democracy. Democracy, timocracy, oligarchy, aristocracy, and a dictatorship. Those are the five that Plato talks about. And an oligarchy basically is a society back in the day, and again, we copied everything from Greek culture here in this country for the most part, European culture. And an oligarchy basically is a society that is ran by just a few people, a few families, right? And the one thing about an oligarchy in that book he breaks down and what destroys an oligarchy is one, you had people who just did whatever they wanted to do. You didn't have expertise in the field. You said, you know what, I don't know nothing about shoes, but I got money and shoes are selling right now, so I'm going to make shoes. The second thing is that the society started to eat away at its core. People were all mixed up. You had things like Sodom and Gomorrah going on. You know, people, you know, gay and all this other different things. And you start to see how this oligarchy broke down and eventually, you know, was destroyed or overtaken by another power. So, you know, when you look at America and you say, okay, is this a democracy? No, no. When you understand Greek history, this is an oligarchy. This is what this society is. And everybody out there, please go look that word up. That's a serious, serious thing. This is what the society is, and it's basically ran by a few families who have understood power, understood war, and have taken control of every aspect of our lives, from health, economic, the prison industrial system, to this new GMO thing that's going on right now with the fake genetically modified food. I mean, the list goes on and on, brothers and sisters, of what these people who are in power are doing to remain in power. Right? You know, we call them the Bilderberg, or you want to look at the 13th, whatever you want to Illuminati, whatever you want to call it, there is a force out here that is made up of a small group of people that are controlling everything. Everything.
Yep.
And it's a shame. You know, it really is sad. And, you know, they call us sheeple. The Jews call us goyim, G-O-Y-M. They think we're dumb, y'all. They said them different people ain't. They stupid. They ain't never going
to
catch on.
Because they are dumb. They use TV to dumb us down. Mm-hmm. They use the food to dumb us down, the water to dumb us down, all the chemicals they put in, everything.
Mm-hmm.
Even a cell phone.
Chemtrails they spraying on top of us at night.
Night and during the day. I see it all day.
Mm-hmm. Yep. That's serious, sister.
So they are dumb.
All right. Let's try one more call, guys. This is...
All right.
Number 9273, question, comment, or sipping tea?
Yes, I have a comment, and I guess I'm one of the oldest ones that's on the radio tonight. I'm 57 years old, and when I was growing up in the 60s and going to church, church wasn't only during that time for religion. That was our parents' and grandparents' way of having meetings for the civil rights to come out of the bondage that they had been in and our ancestors had been in. So I just want to elaborate to Sister Love that if it wasn't for those civil rights leaders and marchers back in the 60s, we would probably still be on somebody's farming, still under the minimum wage, a very low minimum wage. Can you imagine getting paid $2.60 an hour back in the 1960s? You know, so we have to, I'm older than most of you that's been on this radio tonight, and I lived and I walked and I seen. And a lot of that was, a lot of the churches was where the parents and the grandparents and a lot of the church members will meet. That was their way of meeting without the white people finding out what they was having church service on and not knowing that they had already started brewing up the march with King. So therefore, if it wasn't for our mother, father, grandparents, and great-grandparents, because, see, they had that third eye open, but they did theirs in a remarkable way, where they fooled even the Caucasian, because they didn't know what was about to brew, because it was too many of us, and they couldn't handle it. And when we had that march down in D.C. in 1963, it shut it down. It let them know that we were united all across the country and that we wanted to be treated as human beings. You know, and I thank God for the ancestors, because the ancestors are the ones that helped lead the way. It's not what the churches that we have now, because the churches back then, when I went to church, it was about unity. It was about love. You know, it was about spirituality. And since the 80s, when the drugs start coming in, and then you start getting all these mega churches that are pimping people out of their hard-earned money, where half of them can't even pay the house note because they're trying to live above their means.
Yes.
You know, it's ridiculous.
Uh-huh.
You know,
uh-huh.
And it's a shame. And those are the ones that are so weak that they will let someone dictate to them that they're going to hell if they don't pay their tithes. Which is not true. I give from my heart. And when I give from my heart, I receive blessings. That's my tithing, helping other people.
Uh-huh.
And until we start waking up and start uniting together in this world and opening my eyes, I mean, it's a disgrace to see how the young women and young men in this city and even some of the older black men and black women in this city have let drugs and alcohol take over them. That I can watch them every day, and every day is like a repetitive life. They're doing the same thing. They're going in circles and don't have a clue to what's on around them. But I just wanted to elaborate on that, and peace and love to you all tonight.
Thank you for that, sister. Thank you. Thank you for that point of view.
Thank
great point of view. Great point of view. Really, you know, I think that, you know, especially, you know, sister, thank you for calling in. You know, we must understand the pain and the things that our ancestors went through to, you know, to get us to where we are today. And I feel her frustration. But there was a couple of different things going on simultaneously back then that, you know, give way to what we now see today. As I mentioned earlier, and I don't say that sarcastically or disrespectfully to anybody, but a lot of us, you know, including early church members, especially in the North, we tried to act white, y'all. We wanted to be white. We didn't get along with our cousins from the South. We thought they was, you know, Bama speaking, you know, broken English, crazy niggas. We didn't understand, you know, that they, you know, they had a different way of worshiping. So, you know, when you look at today, you look at these mega churches, you know, they following the template of these white mega churches. Right? There's a template that they've used, and then you know, some of them get exposed, you know, Eddie Long and these different dudes, you know, messing with little kids and all this stuff. It's not by accident you see all this stuff coming out where these preachers are messing with little boys and girls, y'all.
No. That's
you know what I'm saying? This is serious, no?
It is
disgusting.
Disgusting.
And a lot of these people are agents, you know. A lot of these pastors are on TV.
Yes, they are.
They are working for the elite. You know,
because they want to be that right person they could be. They scared of getting that car taken, that house taken. They're afraid.
Yep.
You know, there are some that are speaking truth to power. Now, we had brothers like Isamusha Barashango who said it like it is now. So there are some that put it out there. But, you know, too often we get the Eddie Long type, you know. That, you know what I mean? Too often.
Yeah, too often. And it's really sad, though, because this hinders our people, you know. If you know the truth and you uphold it, then who are you? I mean, you're leading thousands of people, if not millions of people, and you sitting up there and you know the truth, you know the history and the origins of the Bible and Christianity, but you're making profit. While all these people are living in fear, you know, giving up all their money, stand up there, how, you know, and I understand, I get it. We all play a role down here. Whatever we came down here to do, that's what we came here to do. So, you know, to a certain degree, you know, when you look at it on a higher perspective, you can understand, get it. But on a human perspective, it's like, I'm looking at this man, he's up here, he's telling lies. There's thousands of people who adore this person. And it's like, where's the conscious at? Is his conscious seared to where he actually believes his own hype, or does he not have one? I mean, could this be black people with no souls? I mean, what's going on here?
Yeah, in a lot of cases, that's what it is. And again, we don't have souls, or the spirituality ain't right because we cut off the melanin.
Yeah. I'm waiting for the melanin show.
And when it's to talk about paying tithes and stuff, all that comes from, again, the white system of purgatory, where the Catholic Church said that when your family member died, you had to pay for him to go to heaven.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Hey, brothers and sisters, this stuff is serious now.
You wake up. Wake up.
Yeah.
Come on, look, I was there. Look, I'm about to get on y'all level. I was there. I was a Christian. I was scared. I was scared to read and think outside of that Bible. I was scared to ask questions. I was there. So me, of all people, the most scaredest of the scared, if I can do it and broaden my mind and horizons, you can do it too. You can do it too. It starts with you. Don't worry about anybody else if they get you or get it. Worry about yourself.
Yeah, it's your own spiritual
journey. Truth will speak for itself. You don't have to convert anybody over anything. Just get in touch with yourself. Go inside yourself. Get in touch with the Creator. And you will have whatever it is that you're supposed to have in your life. It'll be there, whether it's people, things, whatever. Whatever for you is going to be there for you. So don't be afraid to step out. And if worst comes to worst, the worst thing that can happen is that you end up right back as a Christian.
So, I mean, right. I'm just saying, you won't right. know unless you try. You won't
Great
know.
Great point.
Yep. Yeah, nothing to lose but live.
That's right.
Dang.
Yeah. Yeah, we definitely
say,
have
this
a trouble.
Is a great show.
Yeah, so basically we found out that the story of Jesus comes from like 25 other stories and was created in the Council of Nicaea. Okay, question, Brother Steve. Was Constantine of African, was he black?
No.
Or human, no. melanated?
No, he was a European, what we will call today a European. You know, so that's another thing we have to clearly understand. You know, he didn't get baptized till 3 days before he died. Now, if you creating something and you believe in it, why ain't you one of the first ones that they get baptized? Or, you know,
right.
he needed the political gain. He needed a way to unify the people. He was more worried about power and you know, the consuming power and, you know, being able to get the people to stop fighting and killing each other and to fall under one accord. And it took him a very long time, but eventually they were successful and to, you know, unifying the people. And once they unified the people, they started to spread and do different things like justifying slave trades. You know, that's why the Pope, Nicholas V, authorized King Isabella, Ferdinand, and Don Juan, the kings and queens of Spain and Portugal, to go ahead. He said, you know, y'all stop fighting each other, man. Both you nations are now authorized to enslave all infidels. Which were Africans.
Yep. All right. Say it again. The Pope authorized slavery.
Authorized the slave trade.
That was like back in 14 something, or was it before the 1400s?
1455.
Yep.
Around that area.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I remember learning that.
Well, we gotta clearly. Nicholas V was his name. So we gotta start, paying attention to that. You know, why did they start? You know, fighting back and forth over who will be the first ones to bring us to this part of the country, right? You know, what was their purpose? You know, Nicholas V, again, in 1452, actually, you know, from that you had the first castle built at Almenia on the Gold Coast in 1482, where Bartholomew Diaz played an influential part in that. Then you had the first Portuguese missionary, and I'm going off memory, 1490 in the Congo, where the Portuguese went to the Congo. You know, from there, you know, it goes all the way down to where you had the sugar plantations being set up in the early 1500s. Then you had the Spanish jump in 1510. From that, then you fast forward all the way to the first permanent English colony in Jamestown in 1607. Right, so you gotta dig and you gotta look back and you say, man, how are you a person of good? You're telling me this religion is good and God loves all people, but you authorizing the slave trade?
Mm.
Like, you know, it just doesn't
all
people.
Well.
Come on now, let's get this common sense now. Let's get the basics. Let's get down to the basics of this.
If we get past this point, you guys, I promise you, it's smooth sailing from then
yes,
on.
Yes, it is. It's just logic. Everybody ain't got to be a historian. Everybody ain't got to love history. It's just logic, you know?
Yeah.
You're telling me you're a part of a religion that authorized the enslavement of millions of people? You know how many people died on those ships on the ways over here? Do we understand what Christopher Columbus really did? This is serious situations that we just ignore. You know what we suffer from, sisters? We suffer from what's called a selective amnesia.
Yeah,
we forget what we need
to
remember.
I say it all the time.
Remember
right.
what we don't need. It's a serious
right.
thing. Selective amnesia.
So true. I'm so happy we have this show tonight. Oh my gosh, I just hope we touched a lot of people. Hope some people are going to start reading. For me, it was actually in the Bible, in the book of Matthew, where the Jesus character says, learn of me. Learn. So I'm like, all right, I'm going to learn. So the more I learn, the more I start to some bush. A lot, you know. So that was how I came into where I'm at. I learned it was a lot. I mean, I love you got to take that time to learn. Seek.
Yeah.
What does it say? Yeah. Seek ye, whatever it says. I used to know that stuff by heart. But so
because
really, actually, for me, the Bible, I can apply it better now that I have more understanding of what's going on metaphysically than I did when I was in Christianity. Now, I throw Bible quotes that I don't even know how I remember, like, and I can apply it to a situation, not being a Christian, but just plain old common sense. I mean, stuff is just, you don't have to be a rocket scientist, but it's more practical.
That's a great point. I'm one that always says that, no matter what, if it makes you a better person, then that's okay with me. I'm not, you know, all the stuff that I've learned, and I'm very grateful and I'm thankful to the Creator that I have the ability to not let this harden me. Because when you study and you read and you learn a lot of stuff, you get a lot of dudes that just be like, man, you know, F that religion, man, throw that shit in the garbage can, da 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 da. You know, you get real frustrated, you get aggressive, you want to just get rid of it. But my thing is, like, you know, there is some core things that are inside of that they got from us that are just universal truths. And if you use it the right way and if you become a better person, then that's all good with me.
What comes around goes around. Do unto others as they have you do unto them. I mean, it's all the same cliches, people. It's the same thing, same message.
Yeah, those are part of the laws of the universe. Some of those.
Same thing.
Brother, I want to thank you, sisters, for doing this show.
I really do, because this is a powerful thing that you sisters are doing. Keep doing what you're doing, you know, because we need to get this information out there. We only have so many ways of getting this information out here, and this is one of them.
You sisters are doing a great job of
putting forth the effort and having the, you know, what we call fortitude to be able to speak truth to power, because, you know, a lot of our people, we're just, you know, we're scared. We're scared. Fear is at the core of all our problems, y'all.
Yes, say it again, Brother Steve. That's
here.
It.
Mm-hmm. Brother Steve, I would like to close out with you kind of telling us, can you just give us a quick synopsis of your book, the two books that you have out, and where people can purchase them at?
Okay, yeah, definitely. You can. I have a website. It's called swjbooks.com, swjbooks.com. You could order my books off of there. The first one was called Wake Up, Young Black Male, Life is What You Make It. The second one was geared for the young brothers and sisters. It's called How Did I Get Here from a Kushite to a Thug? It's breaking down how we came from Kush to now where we're thugs. It's a historical book. It breaks down everything from about 1000 B.C. until now. The book I'm getting ready to put out in about a month is I'm very, very proud of. I've worked on for Brother Roger and I have worked on for the last 2.5 years. It's called Conversations with My Elders. Now, this book is basically a resource book, and each chapter has a conversation that I've had with an elder. Elders like Dr. Uhuru Hotep, Brother Raj, Dr. Kaba, different elders that I've had during my travels. I've sat down and I've dealt with them on topics like racism, poverty, rites of passage, health, melanin, all kinds of topics that has that conversation, as well as a resource guide. Each chapter also has a resource guide. It breaks down what foods to eat. For instance, on the health chapter, we have a section on melanin, how to eat the right foods, how to get the right sleep, the difference between acid and alkaline. So, you know, it's a resource book. So that's the third book we'll be putting out here pretty soon. It's in the editing process right now. So look out for that. But, yeah, you can reach me. I mean, you can find the books on all the European outlets. You know, you have to do that in this country to be able to make it available. You know, it's on Kindle, Nook, all different European outlets. But if you want to support a brother, go to swjbooks.com and you can order the stuff off of there. And we'll be setting up for pre-orders for this new book here in about a month or so. So if you'd like to pre-order it, feel free to do so. And again, sisters, I thank you so much for this opportunity because, you know, to get opportunities to share this, and it's not enough for me to just have this. I say it all the time. You got dudes that understand this knowledge, but they just sitting on a couch. You know, they ain't done nothing with it. You got to get up off that damn couch, man. Share this with somebody,
that's
man.
That's right. That's right. Start writing books. Start doing shows. Start getting that information out here. Thank you so much for doing what you do, Brother
Steve. We appreciate you so much, Brother Steve. And thank you for all your wisdom and knowledge. And we definitely need to have you back on the show because there are a lot of other topics that our listeners need to know about. I mean, like I said, after this episode, you guys, we're going full throttle. It gets better from here. So,
anytime you need me, you give me a call. I'm there for you.
All right. Thank you so much. We appreciate you, brother. Thank you so much.
No doubt. Hotel, sisters.
Remember, listeners, it's not about the destination. It's about the journey. And this is Mystic Feather signing off. Love you all.
All right.
And
love
this is...
This is Holistic Gals. Thank you guys for joining us. And we'll be back for Thorough Body Thursdays at 9 p.m. Love and light.
All right. This is Sister Love. I love you all. Thank you so, so very much for tuning into our show. We're so excited to have you. We love all of our listeners. Please tune in again on Thursday for our show. Peace and light and love. Bye.
Bye. Bye-bye. Night-night.